Allahu Akbar.
What I want to do, inshallah, we already know, and let's be real about this thing, that racism is present amongst Muslims. We know outside of Islam, outside of our community, it exists. And particularly, as he was mentioned, 45, he really pushed it even more in the face of the people. And that's what those were the people who were the ones that voted for him, some people, not all people, voted for him, who were about his program, which was to keep this country divided. And the shame of it all is that even before he got in that position, we had racism amongst ourselves. Based on the color of our skin, based on the hair, based on a lot of different things. You're not from my region, you don't speak my language. So we have many things just amongst ourselves, and we need to face the fact that we don't like particular individuals only because of the color of their skin or because of their race. That is not from the Deen Islam. And I'm going to talk about two different steps. First step I'm going to talk about is a hearing back to the Quran and Sunnah, because our success lies with adhering to the Quran and Sunnah. And then, inshallah, I'm going to give you some steps we can take in order to maybe even possibly get rid of or begin to tear down the wall of racism between ourselves. First of all, let's start with the ayah from Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, Inna hadhihi ummatukum ummatun wahidatun wa ana rabbukum fa'budun. Well, Allah says in a particular ayat, he says, Verily this brotherhood of yours is a single brotherhood, and I am your only Rabb, or your only Lord. Worship me alone. And this comes from Surah 21, ayat 92. And also Allah mentions to us, Muslims. He said, And hold fast altogether by the rope of Allah, by the rope which Allah stretches out for you, which is Islam, this deen. And be not divided amongst yourselves, and remember with gratitude Allah's favor upon you. And so we instructed two things here. One, to hold on to this deen, Islam. And the second thing is to what? Is to not divide amongst ourselves, because that is not from the deen, Islam. Also, the Prophet he said this in his final farewell address. He only made one Hajj. Maybe you didn't know. Maybe you thought he made many. He made one Hajj, and at the particular Hajj, he addressed people. He had like 100,000 people, and he said this to the people, and this even applies to today. It wasn't just for the people then; it's for us now. He said, "O people, be aware, your God is one." No Arab has any superiority over a non-Arab, and no non-Arab has any superiority over an Arab. No white one has any superiority over a black one, and no black one has any superiority over a white one, except on the basis of taqwa, meaning piety. And the most honor among you in the sight of Allah is he who is most pious and righteous. It's not about the skin color, because your hair is different from my hair, your skin is lighter or darker than my skin. That's not what it's all about. Or because you're from this region of this particular country, and I'm from that region of this particular country. No, the greatness does not lie there. Your greatness, in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is how pious you are, your taqwa, and also how righteous you are. These are the things that are more important than anything else. Than any color, because none of us in this room stood in the line like we go to McDonald's and we look on the menu and we say, okay, I want this color hair, give me a little side of blackness over here, and then give me nose like this. No, we didn't get in that line. What we did is our parents got together, they had sex, and they had us. Now, I'm being straight up. That's how we got here. And we didn't have a choice on that, on our parents. We can say, oh, give me those two parents over there. Let me get rid of it. I don't want these people over here. No. Our parents are the ones that got together, and this is how we are. And this is who we are. And alhamdulillah, this is how Allah Ta'ala made us. This is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not from me, or not from you. Allah said, this is how you're going to look. This is how you're going to be. So I have to accept how I look and how I am. Understand, brothers and sisters in Islam. It's not about your lineage. Now, when you get married, it's four things, the four reasons why a person gets married. But one thing is most important. What are the four reasons for people getting married? Give it to me, sisters or brothers. One is what? Which one? Their religion, and the other one is their lineage, their wealth, and their beauty. But of course, Rasulullah said, if you marry a person based on their religion, okay, alhamdulillah, that's a good thing. That's what you should look for. You get the other three, that's like a bonus. A little beauty, a little family lineage, and also money. Oh, that's a bonus. I'm for that. I'm open to that. And you should be too. That's a little extra something on your plate. But Islamically, from Rasulullah, he said, because this lineage is not important. He said, in a hadith, he said, Allah will not inquire about your lineage on the day of resurrection. The most honorable in the sight of Allah is he who is more pious or most pious. Again, that word piety comes back up. That taqwa comes back up. It's not about your lineage. So what? Your family is so and so and so and so and so what? So what? It means nothing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because on Yawm al-Din, when before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we're naked and we're uncircumcised. He's not going to say, okay, all the people from this family, Abdul Rahman's family, you go over here. All the ones over here from Muhammad's family, you go over here. Okay, anyone from Abdul Rahman, okay, you guys are good. Anyone from Muhammad's family, not Muhammad the prophet, but anyone from Muhammad's family, you know, not so good. It doesn't work like that. Piety on that day is going to be more and more important. Now, let's go to beauty. Some of you probably look in the mirror before you got here today and say, oh man, you're looking good this morning. Okay, and you probably are, and you are looking good to me. But is that important on Yawm al-Din? La, no, nay. It says here in a hadith, it says, Allah does not see your outward appearance or your possession, but he sees your hearts and your deeds. What's in your cup, your heart, and the deeds that you do, because when you go to your grave, kulli nafsin dha'iqatul maut, every soul will have a taste of death. The thing that goes to your grave with three, your family and your wealth and your deeds go with you to the grave. But then you go into the grave, what goes into the grave with you are your deeds, because your family and your wealth, you hear them walking away from you. But only thing that you're going to be concerned with, it won't be about your beauty. It won't be about your possessions. It'll be about the deeds that you have. And then those are the things, inshallah, that's going to benefit you or not benefit you on Yawm al-Din. Now, what does brotherhood look like in this deen, Islam? It was mentioned, we know the fact that the Prophet ﷺ, when he went to Medina, from the first Islamic state, what was the first thing he did other than build the masjid? The masjid, the Prophet's mosque. He established between Ansar and Muhajirin brothers. He said, you Ansar and you Muhajirin, you are now brothers to each other. And the ones, Muhajirin, is the one that came from Mecca and made the hijrah. And then Ansar was the one that already was living in Medina. And he made them brothers. And they shared with each other. Where one brother, he said to another brother, he said, look, man, look here. I got two wives. I don't know any brother over here may do that. And maybe no sister want to even hear this. He said, I have two wives. You tell me which one you want, I will divorce her, and then once she's eligible, you can marry her. And the brother said, you know, I'm good. Just show me where the marketplace is, and I go there and I earn my own money. This is the brother who we talking about. This brother was willing to give up one of his wives. You tell me which one you want, and I'll divorce her, no problem, and she's all yours. This is a beautiful brotherhood we talk about here. Where the brother, he wanted to share so much, he even willing to divorce one of his wives for the share with the brother what he had. Now, the Prophet ﷺ, he said, well, you all probably heard this before, none of you will have faith till he wishes for his brother what he wishes for himself. Or loves for his brother what he loves for himself. He didn't say, I'm not picking on anyone from this particular country. He didn't say, because he's Pakistani, and then you're going to give to him. No. Or because you're African American, you're going to give to him. No. He said, loving for your brother what you love for yourself. It doesn't matter where he or she's from. It's just the fact that she's your brother and you want good for your brother. That's your sister and you want good for your sister. Sometimes what happens is when we give salam to some people, they don't get salam back. Because you're from one race and I'm from another race, And the Rasul said, he spread the salam. Give the salam to each other. But sometimes, because I'm African-American, and I give salam to someone who's not African-American, you may not, which one to use your breath? Well, you should be giving, be happy to give salam. I say, assalamu alaikum. You say to me, wa alaikum salam, with a nice smile. Or you say to me, or you give me more, I say, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. So you got to at least give me equal to that. Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullah. Or wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh. To the end. You could do this kind of thing. But my brothers and sisters, Islam, sometimes we don't even want to give salam to each other. Maybe because of race. Maybe because you're racist. Maybe because you don't like me. Maybe you're having a bad day. I don't know. But what I do know is that the Prophet of Islam, he said, give the salam. Spread the salams. Now let me tell you a story real quick about racism, how Prophet Islam he frowned upon it. It was a situation where two brothers, one Abu Darda, and he was arguing with Bilal. And you know Bilal, the first Muadhin. They were arguing with each other over some clothing or something like that. And then Abu Darda, he said to Bilal, because he got kind of angry with him, he said, you cannot comprehend this, or you son of a black woman. And so they went to the Prophet, someone told the Prophet about this. So the Prophet asked Abu Darda, he said, hey, come over, let me talk to you. And he said, basically, did you say what you said? He said, well, he was ashamed, because he saw on the Prophet's face how mad he was. He said, yeah, I said it. And he said, in you, it's jahiliyyah. In you of what you used to do before, and that's not from the Deen Islam. The Deen Islam eradicates this kind of behavior, eradicates this kind of attitude of saying to a person similar to, and what he said, oh, he said, you cannot comprehend that you're stupid. You son of a, he said what we normally say, son of a, no, he said, you son of a black woman, which pretty much counts it as being the same thing. Or call him, as the brother said earlier, he called him the N-word. And so, Brother Abu Darda, he went to Bilal's house, and he went to where his threshold was, and he put his head down like this, and he said to Bilal, he said, I am not going to raise my head up until you sort of walk on my neck. And so Bilal saw him down there. He said to him, he said, the only thing I'm going to do is that I'm going to kiss that forehead. So we see, brothers of Islam, that the Prophet of Islam, he frowned upon racism in this deen. And alhamdulillah, Bilal, instead of being mad at his brother, he said, no, I'm not going to do that. I love you, my brother, and I'm going to show you how much I love you, and I will kiss you on your forehead instead of walking on your neck. I'm going to just say a couple more things, and I will be finished. Well, what this should be all about, brothers and sisters, what Allah says in the one eye in the Quran, when he says, the believing men and the believing women are allies of one another. They enjoin what is right and forbid what is wrong, establish prayer, give zakat, and obey Allah and His messenger. Those Allah will have mercy upon them. Indeed, Allah is exalted in might and wisdom. And so we see from this, we are allies. We are allies to each other. We are friends to each other. We are to help each other. It doesn't matter what the color of the skin. It doesn't matter where you're from. You are my brother. You are my sister. You are closer to me than my own non-Muslim brothers and sisters. I love you for the mere fact that you're my Muslim brother and Muslim sister. Because one time that an angel came and he visited one of the companions. And he was on his road to see one of his companions. And the angel said to him, like, where are you going? He said, I'm going to such and such house. He said, well, do you owe him anything? He said, I don't owe him anything. Is he expecting you? No, he don't expect me. And he said, I'm just going to see him because I love him. And the angel said, because you love him, Allah love you in the same way. Just for merely going to visit his brother, just because. Now, let me get to this last step. And none of us is chipping away. Like, we got brothers and sisters divided right now. That's the kind of war of Islamic we should have. But not the wall of racism with one group of people on this side, one group of people on that side. And that should not be. I'm not talking about what we're doing right now. This is okay Islamically. But I'm talking about having this divided wall between you and between me just based on my color of my skin. How do we start breaking those down? I'm going to make a little list here. One of the things that we can do, inshallah, is that we can start having imams exchange go to different jummas. For example, I'm an imam, and I talk to mostly African Americans. And there may be a imam that mostly talk to, for example, Pakistanis. And so myself and that imam, on the second Friday of every month, we switch. And I go talk to his community, he go talk to my community. And we do that every for a few months, and just on the second of every month, we go and we talk to each other's community. Another thing that we can do is that Eid, and I guys picked this particular Eid al-Ahad. Ramadan's coming up soon, maybe less than 60 days, inshallah. But I picked on the one today, the Eid sacrifice, because it doesn't involve money. Because what happened, whenever we had to eat a joint Eid together, I'm talking about having a joint Eid. We have a joint Eid together and they have all these boxes lined up, like the brothers sitting there would line up with boxes, then the people always seem to go to the box of their community only and they don't want to give, they say, we're the box of so-and-so and so-and-so. They put all their money in that box and forget it, and the other boxes are like empty, like you can just see a little dust in there. And so what I'm saying, brothers and sisters, if we have a joint Eid, maybe do the one where there's no money involved, because money kind of make people a little bit crazy. And so we have an Eid all together where, inshallah, there's no money involved. Another thing I could do, and this is Ramadan coming up. And when Ramadan comes up, the shaitan is locked up. That means that we're a little bit freer to do what we think. A little bit freer to act on our own without being influenced by shaitan. So one of the other things that we can do, maybe ourselves go from one Ramadan to go to one Jummah to another Jummah. Because we all, alhamdulillah, we go to Jummah. And so instead of me on the second Friday of the month during Ramadan, going to the one I usually go to, maybe I go to a Jummah somewhere else. Or brother and sister, I can go to Iftar. I can go, inshallah, if I'm over here in my community, we're going to have iftar. Instead of going there, maybe every other week, I'll go to iftar somewhere else, where I blend in with other people other than those that I see every day, or that look like me. And so these are just some of the things that we can do. We can do at this conference, and this is the last couple of things I'm going to say. We can do at this very conference, meet someone from another community, meet someone from another region. We can start right now and not wait till next week or the week after or the after. Kevin. We don't have to wait that long. Let's do it right now. It's about action. At this particular conference, it's about action. It's not about, oh, here, good, I feel good kind of thing. No, it's about let's implement these things now. My thing is like, why not? Why not introduce myself to my brother who's from Puerto Rico? Why not introduce myself to a sister, a brother who is from Pakistan? Why not do that? Maybe I ask him about his name. Maybe what he likes to do. Maybe what city he's from. And brother, I'm not talking after you to go approach the sisters. No, sister approach the brothers. Don't say Imam Amin said, oh yeah, hey sis, what's up? Yeah, boy, what's going on with you, hon? No, don't put that on me. That's on you. If you decide you want to push up on the sister, a sister want to get up in the brother's face, that's between you and Allah. Don't put that one on me. What I'm saying is that for brothers, to introduce yourself to a brother who is not from your clan, I'm going to say for right now, and sisters do the same thing, so you start breaking down that wall. That war that divide us, divide between us. And then you start seeing the alhamdulillah more and more and more. We get closer and closer. Now, young people, and this is going to be my last thing. A lot of times, and I'm not saying any parent in particular, a lot of times the parent teaches you some of the things that you know. And because if they act like racists, you're going to probably end up being a racist too. And so don't use that for an excuse. Your parents are saying something about this person, that person. That is no excuse. You go about by the Prophet of Islam, what he did and what he said and how he interacted with the people as he did with Brother Abu Darda. Where he said, in you is jahilil. In you is still ignorance from before you became Muslim. So I'm saying to my young people here, on the females and the male side, is that let's begin something new. Let's begin to interact with people outside of your race, outside of your home, and don't be afraid to do so. The deen needs this. Our strength lies in our togetherness, not dividing from each other. Wala tafarraqu, do not divide amongst yourselves. So my respected brothers and sisters in Islam, please, it begins with us. Let's start, inshallah, coming more closer together, getting to know people for opposite, for different from your own race, and don't be afraid to do so. Brothers, introduce yourself to a brother from another, okay, from another culture. Sisters, you know what? Do the same thing. Introduce yourself to a sister from another culture. But of course, if you're interested in someone from another culture, that's from another opposite sex of you, then it has the marital here, so you can go downstairs, pay your money, okay, and do it right. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.